Well, we have been talking a lot about this issue on the program, high-frequency trading. 2010 could be the year high-frequency traders find themselves caught up in new rules and regulations in D.C. Some on Wall Street argue high-frequency trading adds liquidity and benefits the market, but our next guest has been saying, no way. He's Joe Saluzzi, co-head of Themis Trading. His firm does not do high-frequency trading, which, Joe, would be, some say, the reason why you don't support it.
I love that claim. No, actually, I mean, our firm has been around, we've been 7 years, and before that we were at InstantNet for a number of years, my partner Sal Arnick and I. We've seen high-frequency trading many years for now. Okay, this is nothing new on Wall Street, and most people realize that. But what's happened over the last 2 years, particularly since Reg NMS came out in 07, it has exploded. Now you're talking about something which is no longer just a small force with a natural, you know, there's buyers, there's sellers, there's arbitrage guys and so on. They dominate now. And when one segment of the market dominates volume up to 70%, it's not healthy. And we've used this, you know, the example of an ocean and an ecosystem.
So then where are they in the markets now?
Where are they? They're everywhere.
But why is that bad?
Yeah.
Okay, here's the problem. Let's look at a typical example during the day, and you'll see these every day. This chart's the same pattern. You'll see some sort of movement in the morning, and then you'll see this flat line. That's pretty much called a mean reversion strategy. That's taken out the volatility of the market all day long. And these guys know how to back test, and they see all the, you know, they know what's going on. And basically, it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. It goes on all day long. And the question that we have is, are asset prices effectively being mispriced at this point? Is there too much volume being pushed in one direction? For instance, now they're all buyers. But it doesn't mean that they may not be sellers tomorrow. So everybody's happy now. No one's complaining because the market's up 66% from the lows. But we really have a market structure problem here. The U.S. equity market is no longer the model for the world.
But I would argue then that the markets would just go up and up and up. If these guys are really dominant, then why would they want to see a market go down? Then they would just keep pushing the markets higher and higher.
You know what? It's going to take a shock to the system to move it. And I point back to the after Thanksgiving, the Dubai scenario. You thought that we would go down after that, but it came right back up. So back to your point, yes, they could easily push them back higher, because if you were going lower, you need a short sale, which means you need a tick. Well, not yet, but maybe soon. But that's a lot tougher because you need to borrow, naked borrowing and stuff. But look, the bottom line is that's one segment that we have a problem with. The other part is liquidity, and if you want to talk about that, I'd love to.
Well, first of all, Joe, in Washington right now, there are some that are pushing this idea of a transaction tax, and they're pointing to these traders, these high-frequency traders, as the reason for that. And I don't think you would be supportive of something like that, a cost for every trade on top of what you already have to pay.
Look, I'm not about taxes, and I don't think that you can signal out one group and say, you know, they're responsible, so you have to tax them. That's not the issue here. And by the way, we know the government will just spend that money somewhere else and go into a slush fund, right? So, no, I'm not about that. But what I think you can expect out of Washington, and probably shortly, within the next month or so, we've got a concept release coming out of the SEC, which is going to start to look at some of these liquidity detections. We've got a large trader authorization rule, which basically will say, we're going to tag these guys. Now they're going to start to study what's going on, finally. And then you'll probably get a naked access situation where some of these guys is a systemic risk, potentially, because they're not being regulated properly, because they're not brokers.
Now, let me ask you this. So please, I'm going to take the other side of the argument, and that is liquidity. So take a stock like a GE or an Apple. If these guys come in and they're trying to make these little tiny trades every 10, 15 seconds, maybe even quicker, at least there's a bid and there's an offer. So if you're a retail guy, at least you know you can get your stock done.
Well, I'll say there is that the liquidity is being added to spots where we don't need the liquidity. The top 100 or so large cap stocks don't need any more liquidity. Citibank does not need liquidity when it trades a billion shares a day. Mm-hmm. So they're playing in there because that's where they can make the most money.
But
where
can
they're
they
not
manipulate
playing,
City? If City's that
no,
big, do,
City's
do they
a
really
different
manipulate
story.
It?
No, that's a liquidity rebate game that they play all day long. They're just going back and forth. But where they really cause problems in the predatory aspect is when these small to mid caps, and I'll point to a New York Stock Exchange study that they did recently, which said that, yes, spreads shrunk, and liquidity was increased in large cap names. But in the small to mid-cap space, it's just the opposite.
Right.
Liquidity has decreased, volatility has increased because now you have predatory action. And a lot of guys out there know what I'm talking about. When you place your bid, all of a sudden there's a guy ahead of you. Or you go to lift an offering, there's 5,000 out there, you get 400 shares, but you got a sub-penny price improvement. And where'd the other 4,600 go?
Okay.
That's the problem that we have here. Okay? And to be honest, we're a little bit tired of that.
Okay. And I think that study you mentioned, it was like liquidity in the top 100 stocks or something like that. Okay, Joe, good to see you as always. Joe Saluzzi of Themis Trading. We're going to be talking merger mania in 2010 after the break.